everybody. This is Raul for Bass Musician Magazine, and today we have the great honor and pleasure of chatting with bassist Robert Harper. Robert is hailing from Bowie, Maryland. I'm not sure. I guess I would always call it Bowie, but English is challenging that way. Originally from California. So, Robert, I'm sure a lot of people want to kind of get to know you. Tell us kind of from the beginning about your bass journey. How did you get started in this?
Well, Raw, first of all, thanks for that introduction and thanks for having me, man. And it's very important for guys like you to be in this kind of business to keep the bass community alive. To answer your question, I started off, you know, when I was younger, I'm talking about elementary school, I was always into entertaining, mm-hmm. you know, dancing, singing, and also I was a good artist, you know. So I went from there, you know, doing the Jackson 5 stuff, you know, back in the days, the ABC and all that stuff. So just being a good dancer back then, it wasn't until I hit my first talent show in the fourth grade and we did a dancing machine. But now this was kind of usual. We didn't have a whole group. It was two of us on first place.
Yeah.
So that kind of really kind of sparked some more interest in it. I was also, don't laugh, into ventriloquist dummies at the time. You know what I mean? Yeah, I loved the great Paul McCarthy.
Mm-hmm.
And Willie and Tyler and all those guys back in them days. And I had a couple of dummies and stuff, and I did that for a while. And this is still elementary school now.
Sure.
I'm reading the books, How to Throw Your Voice and all this, and I was really getting into it. To keep with the music, though, the music took over, what was that? When I got out of the sixth grade, it was a summer, and my mother had me spend it. I'm from Carson City originally.
Okay.
In the summer, excuse me, I did a, what was that? Stay with my uncle for the summer, and I was a stay-at-home kid while he was at work, and I looked out the window and I saw a big crowd. So to get along with this story, young kids are always curious about what's going on. I walk outside and I go over to the crowd, and I can hear like people tuning up. I still didn't know what was going on, and so I'm short, so all I remember is peering through a bunch of legs. My face saw a dude with a guitar. And that was the first time ever. I was only like, 11 or something like that, 12, that I saw somebody, you know, in real life, living color with a guitar, and he was doing the wah-wah, making it talk.
Mm-hmm.
I was struck since then. Excuse me. So then I went home that summer, and of course I asked my mother for a guitar. And she's the big business lady. Mm-hmm. She wasn't into the music thing that well. And so she kept procrastinating. And I hit my darling, beloved grandmother up, who's my second mother, you know? She was always into music. I didn't think about hitting her up first. And she took me to Hollywood. There was a big music store, the biggest one out there. I can't remember the name. It's not there no more. It was on Vine and Sunset. The hugest store out there. She took me there, and she told him I was interested in a guitar. First, he brought me the little Tito Jackson guitar.
Mm-hmm.
You got to remember, I'm happy to get anything that says looks like a guitar.
Oh, yeah.
You know, nothing about the difference between bass or guitar. So I played that and fooled around with that. And then he said, and they have a bass guitar, the salesman said. And when he put that on Raul, it was like, this is me. My mind at that age said, four big strings seem easier to play than six little ones. A little common sense back then, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And so that's why I originally played, not because what I heard from records prior to that, but it just seemed like it was more simple at the time. So anyway, moving right along, I got that bass, and at first, you know, it was like another toy. I was surprised. I would play with it a little bit, and then go out and play football. I was so much into sports, you know what I mean? We played football right out there in front of our house where we lived. It was a suburban area, so we didn't have to worry about too much traffic and stuff. We played touch football or whatever right out there in the streets. And then one rainy day, I was locked in. Nobody outside to play with. And I grabbed a bass, and I had my little Sears amplifier that my stepfather got me, you know. with a little four-inch speaker and a little cloth covering when you can't tell what's going on back there.
Oh, yeah.
Got a big speaker, but it's nothing like this once you pull the cloth off. But anyway, it must have been about 5 or 10 watts. And I was fumbling around like I always do because I had not started taking lessons yet. And I ran across a groove that I heard before. And I said, wait a minute. And I backed it up and I played them notes. Dun, 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 dun. I said, that's Skin Tight.
Yeah.
So that was my first song I learned how to play. I just stumbled on it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of weird because I'm known in the bass community as a funk bassist. And I'm like, check that out.
Yeah.
First song, Skin Tight. And when I came in, it was like it dropped from the heavens. So from there, you want me to keep talking about this? Keep
sure. Absolutely.
I went from there. I could write a book, but let's keep it more condensed. I went from there. So then I started taking. My mother seen me practicing a lot,
mm-hmm.
and she's gonna give me some lessons. So they started dropping me off at this Wilson's Music Store that's no longer in Carson, California, and I took them little 30-minute lessons every week. And then I wasn't playing any bands. I was just happy to come home and jam to the records and stuff. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And it finally got to a point where, you know, I was starting to learn a lot of tunes. Part of me, Funkadelic had arrived on the scene, you know, real big, and all the P-Funk stuff. And all, where my fact, funk was just busting out the scene at that time. I was 14, and I was in junior high, and I was just sitting there having lunch one day, and one of the football players, he was like this big, popular football player, but he also can play guitar. I didn't know that. He jumped on the table, and I was like, whoa, you know, he's real, like, kind of intimidating kind of fella, but
mm-hmm.
he jumped on the table while I was eating lunch, and he said, hey, man, I heard you playing bass. You play bass? I said, yeah. He said, you're going to play bass in my band. Here's my phone number. Call me. And he just left. And I'm like, okay. So, you know, I didn't have a car at the time. He stayed on the other side of this little city. It was too far to walk. My stepfather dropped me off. I called him, and he told me what time to be there. And I went to the rehearsal, and I got the gig. So that was my first time playing at a talent show for junior high.
Gotcha.
Rode right along. Beautiful story. When we did a talent show, we had an introduction. It was Peter Frampton's Do You Feel Like We Do?
Mm-hmm.
Remember that?
I do.
And the bass goes, dum, 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 dum. That's the opening, right?
Yeah.
We had the lights off, and back then we were in the strobe lights. So we had the strobe light on. It was pitch dark. And they announced us. And they hit that strobe light, and I hit the first two notes, and all the girls jumped up and started screaming. And that just solidified the bass game with me right there.
You're on the hook.
Wow. You know what I mean? It was so loud. The Mr. Amright, I'll never forget his name. He was the vice principal. He had to turn the lights back on and tell them to conduct themselves if they want us to go on with this talent show. And I was ready to go after that.
Yeah.
Nice performance. We had a great time. I had a new girlfriend for a while. To the stardom wore off.
There you go.
I had a cheerleader in the crowd, you know, in the cheerleading squad. She helped me wrap up my stuff and everything. My mother rented me the biggest. I forgot the name of that. And it starts with an R. That'll roll in. Something else. But she bought me this big old, you didn't see too many stacks with kids playing with stacks back then, but she rented me a big old stack for the talent mm-hmm. show, and that was great. Moving on along to high school, I did the 10th grade, I was just filling it out. Tai Chi school was a total shock to me. So I did the 10th grade, I just kind of, you know, felt my way around. 11th grade, I got tired of leaving my bass at home. So I said, I better take some music class at school. So I enrolled in stage band,
mm-hmm.
choir. That's a good thing, too. We'll talk about that later. The choir really developed my voice. But anyway, so what I did was I got into a talent show. We got all these band members that have been playing for a while and stuff. We put this great band together, and we did all these covers, and we did a whole talent show for a whole week. So that was nice. We did, let me see, I think it was 3 days and 2 nights.
Nice.
So I felt a little superstar. Then that same band, I got my first gig at the now defunct Name of the Game club that was in Los Angeles. Everybody knew about that club back in the days. We were 17, underage. And you know how it is. We're supposed to, it was my, the singer's lead vocalist, it was his uncle who was throwing on a fashion show. So he got us in there to perform. We did some Prince, Sexy Dancers, mm-hmm. Michael Jackson stuff. So, and this was some of the tunes we did in the talent show. So that's my first time playing at 17 in a club setting.
Gotcha. And it's always so interesting because kind of the common thread, I think probably a lot of people that will hear this won't really grasp some of the challenges because like when back in the day when you were lifting tunes from records, you had to grab the needle and put it on the right
one.
So if you were anything like I was, you would work the same song over and over again. So you'd play it and then you had to go grab it again, lift that needle, put it up at the risk of scratching your records and all that.
Yeah. And, that was the ticket itself.
Oh, it was just being able to play with records was a challenge where, you know, you're kind of juggling all this stuff where like now, if, you know, you want to replay it, you know, 20 times, you could probably just put it on loop and have it go time after time after time and not touch a thing.
Exactly.
And I think it continuously accentuates the need that we have for music in our schools and education because look what an important part of your life it was. And unfortunately, we're at a time where it's one of the first places they're cutting is the arts and music in education. So picking up, you guys played the club, you were underage. What happened next?
Then going on, moving right along, what I did was I grew up around a lot of people that are now out there really doing their thing. We had a bunch of musicians in the neighborhood. Chucky Booker, mm-hmm. who's a fabulous keyboardist. He started producing the group Troop back in the 90s and a lot of other groups. And then he went off to tour with Janet Jackson's Rhythm Nation as her music director. Now he's with Lionel Richie as their music director. And we were kids in the garage playing together. Well, I didn't play with him, but he played in another band. It was a few years older than us. I used to go watch them all the time and hang out over there. Mm-hmm. And it's amazing. That keeps your spark up when you see somebody a little ahead of you moving right along, you know what I mean? And I remember when I saw him first time on Soul Train, I was at home with my mom, you know, with a bowl of cereal. Mm-hmm. I couldn't believe it. And then we had, you know, Wilton Felder. He recently passed not too long ago from the Jazz Crusaders.
Gotcha.
His son was a bass player a couple years older than me. I used to see him all around the talent shows and stuff. The Thomas brothers, who Chucky Booker was their keyboardist, and that's how I saw them. The Thomas family, they lived up on the hill in Carson, and they were just a total, they were like the ones that everybody was trying to get, you know, model after.
Sure.
Their father was a music teacher, and he had them on point. And they can play anything. Mm-hmm. So I just sitting there and watching. They used to close the garage and practice 3 hours, and I didn't say nothing. They let me sit there, and I would just watch. You know what I mean? It was a joy. So the guitar player from that group went on to play. Chucky Booker hooked him up with Chucky Booker's the godson of Barry, Barry White.
Okay.
So he hooked up Terrence Thomas as guitar player for Barry White. And that went on to Barry White's untimely death, you know. Mm-hmm. Who else? Wow, a lot of cats. Oh, Brian O'Neill of the Bus Boys.
Okay.
He came from our city, you know what I mean? They used to be called Brian and Things. Sorry, Brian.
Yeah.
Had to put it out there. So all these guys were about 4 or 5 years ahead of me, man, and it just encouraged me to keep doing what I'm doing, you know? Mm-hmm. Anyway, so what happened with me is I took a detour for a while. The reason I kind of was behind everybody for a minute there is I went to the Navy.
Okay.
Just so into this independent thing, you know. When I was growing up, I was throwing newspapers when I was 12 on my bicycle. You know, those were the good old days, you know.
Yeah.
And I had my first real job at 14, you know, working at a TV place. And the recruiter caught me during lunch from high school. You know, our school was so big, you can leave the campus at lunch and go, you know, wherever you wanted to go. And so he stopped me, and he talked me into it, and I bid on it. Because I wanted to take music in the Navy.
Okay.
I wanted music school. That's what he got me with. Anyway, I go to the Navy, and I did my stint in the Navy. I stayed close. I was in San Diego, California. I wish I would have went to Germany or somewhere. Because when you stay home, you have the tendency to run back and forth and spend too much money because you're so close. See, if you're in another continent, another country, somewhere, you won't be doing it. Mm-hmm. You know? So anyway, it was what it was. And I remember playing out in the ocean and in the middle of the ocean, you know what I mean? Me and the Marine bands and stuff. And I did that for a while. Then I got out, and right before I got out, I saw an ad in Baseball Magazine? I think it was at the time. The Musicians Institute. It was called the Bass Institute of Technology back then, and Guitar Institute of Technology. And it was they really didn't put the emphasis on Musicians Institute too much. It was a little different back then. They had these several little entities all in one. Mm-hmm. But anyway, I went and I joined up with the Bass Institute, and I said, I'm going to do this. And that's when my knowledge of the bass really started expanding, because we had a guy, Oscar Cartea.
Mm-hmm.
He was a graduating student when I came, and he was so great back then. I mean, he was the first person I saw doing the two-handed tapping stuff, and this is 1983, you know? And he was way ahead of the game, and they hired him. So he was my reading teacher. I had Jeff Berlin was one of my teachers.
Nice.
The great Tim Bogert of Vanilla Fudge.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, back in the 60s and early 70s, real big. That group was big. He used a lot of effects, and he showed me the different things about effects, man. So I was just blessed to be around such pros. You know, they had a lot of visiting faculty. Lewis Johnson, that's when I first met him. He came there.
Mm-hmm.
Nathan East first came there, and I saw Nathan grow. You know, he was busy in the studios, but he wasn't doing all that music directing stuff he's doing now.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, I watch people's careers, and I'm like, wow, okay, this is how it goes. Mm-hmm. And it was just a wealth of information gained there, man. And I did a year stint there, and then I went out and had too many kids. Keeping it real.
There you go. Yeah.
I won't say too many. I don't want to hurt my kids' feelings. But I had 6 children.
That is a fair amount of children.
Yeah, and so that slowed me down.
A little bit, yeah.
I didn't want to leave them there unattended for and everything, so I kind of backed up off the scene for a while.
Mm-hmm.
And raised my family. And but then, you know, by me doing my little spot gigs, I failed to mention another guy. His real name is Benny, but he calls himself Bendrix. He wrote a song with Tina Marie and went out and played with Tina Marie back in the day. So, I grew up with all these guys before all that stuff happened. Him and a lot of guys started tugging at me. You know, what are you doing, man? Come on. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. What's going on? You know, pushing me forward. Excuse me. So they started turning me on to different things and pushing me and let me record with them and, you know, sit in with gigs and different things. And it got to the point where, okay, I'm starting to step out my shell. My kids got older, you know what I mean? So they can kind of do for themselves. Mm-hmm. And I had the space to get out and get back into what I love best, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I went to, what is that? I saw the Lewis Johnson, I'm giving bass player props in this interview.
I'm reading
Bass Player Magazine again.
Yeah.
And I read about a Lewis Johnson signature bass. Now, Lewis Johnson, Larry Graham, Bootsy Collins, all those guys were my idols growing up, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So I was fascinated by getting one of those basses. Made a phone call to the guy, and he told me about the NAMM show for the first time. Now, this was 96, you know what I mean? And I never heard of it before or nothing, and he says, Ted, meet me at the NAMM show, and I'll be there, and you can check out the bass, and we'll talk, right? So I wait, and here it goes. 2 weeks before the show, I call in to buy some tickets.
Yeah, like, nope.
To buy some tickets. Yeah. And you know that's a closed event to the public, and you mm-hmm. can't buy a ticket. You have to know somebody or whatever, be connected with an organization, whatever. Yeah. So I called a lady at the box office in Anaheim, and she told me this spiel and how I couldn't get in. I have to be honest with you. I'm so into this music, I started taking it emotionally. And I got real choked up about the whole thing. So I laugh about it now.
Mm-hmm.
But I called back Dave Bunker from Trekker Guitars.
Gotcha.
Shout out to him. I called him back and I'm trying to stay professional, but my voice is choking. You can tell I'm ready to cry.
Yeah.
and he goes, "What's wrong?" And I go, "Nothing. I can't go to the damn show." And I remember that's just how it sounded when I look back and rehash it.
Yeah.
And he got real quiet on the phone for a while. And he goes, "Okay, man, check out, this is what we're going to do." And he got a way to get me in back in the days. It was much easier back then. Now they check IDs and all this stuff. You know, and that was my first NAMM show where I met Lewis Johnson. George Benson and a few other guys. You know, had a personal talk with him and stuff, and exchanged phone numbers. Mm-hmm. I was really digging that, and I also got my first endorsement for my first NAMM show by accident. To me, I went up to Bang & Loudspeakers,
okay,
and I knew one jazz tune, Autumn Leaves.
Mm-hmm.
Had to learn it for college for a final. I put it together in this little music room for about 2 weeks. Playing these arpeggios and walking around and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I went, this guy had the Les Paul with the gray hair. He's one of the real deals, you know?
Oh, yeah.
And he said, "Hey, you want to play?" And I was like, "I really don't know no jazz stuff." He said, "You don't know no jazz tunes?" I said, "One, Autumn Leaves." He said, "Let's go."
Yeah.
I plugged in and, he played in the right key with me, because at that time I didn't know how to modulate and all that stuff. And transcribe, none of that.
Yeah.
And we played, and when I got finished, he offered me an endorsement. Isn't that something?
Nice.
Right, so that was my first endorsement. And I kind of skipped some parts. When I got to Navy, when I was with my kids, I didn't just stop playing, but it was sporadic. You know, it was here and there. Sure. I call them spot gigs. I don't know if that's a true term, but I made that thing up, you know,
mm-hmm.
where just play here when I can and play there. Play there, go in the studio, help them with that. So I kept, my name kept getting out there. I wasn't trying to get it out there. I was just trying to stay involved. You know what I mean?
Gotcha. So from there, you got your first endorsement and mm-hmm. you were getting back into it more full time. What happened next?
Yes. Well, once I did that, I kind of wanted to, it kind of encouraged me to go out more.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you've been off the scene and you only play here and there, you kind of get in this little box, and then you got to climb out that box. In other words, and to really get out there and get your feet real wet. You know what I mean?
Gotcha.
And that did it for me. It kind of really encouraged me to go out there. Besides, my friends always hounded me, and I talked it over with my wife and I went out there and I did it, and I started playing. And then what I started doing, I'm a real good businessman. I'm not trying to brag or nothing.
No.
I started mapping things out, and what I started doing is, you know, back then it was so, a lot of the studios were still wide open. They weren't closed quite yet. A lot of work everywhere. But what I was doing was I was creating a niche for me, mm-hmm. you know? And what I did was I saw a little space and I said, okay, nobody wants to teach beginners that much, beginner bass players.
Gotcha.
They don't have the patience. I took on that. Next thing I know, I got 20 students a week, more than I can handle. I'm like, wow, what's going on here?
Nice.
So I started fashioning that kind of thinking and everything I was doing. So I said, okay, instead of battling for the major acts all the time, what about all these indie acts around here? You know, because I'm always seeing these ads in Music Connection magazine and mm-hmm. all these. They need this for just the recording, the same things that the major ones needed. So I started diving in that, and that's been my bread and butter even to today. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
There's so many groups unheard of right now that need somebody to come in and record, and their bass player might not show up. I come fill in for them and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I'm giving up some game right now, but it's a lot going on. You know
yeah.
what I mean?
Yeah. So from there you were teaching, you were finding the gigs, and then what happened next?
Oh, okay, let's keep it rolling right
yeah.
along. The second NAMM show, I was a little bit more prepared.
Oh yeah.
And I was out to get my idol's attention, Lewis Johnson.
Mm-hmm.
I said, if I see him again, he's mine.
Yeah.
So what I did was I got there and I practically followed him. I stalked him. But I kept a distance, me and another bass player. And I just met this other bass player while I was there. Mm. He kept this Olympic bass, and he was walking around with it. And I kept a distance in my stalking, and I just followed him around wherever he went. And I said, as soon as he stops, I'm going to play some of his stuff. You know what I mean? So he stopped at LaBella Street. That was one of his endorsements at the time. Mm-hmm. He's over there talking. We were a couple booths away. We plugged in some amplifier company. I can't remember. And I had my back towards him. And I asked my friend. I started playing some Brothers Johnson stuff. You know, I don't know. It was Get the Funk Out of My Face or something. And I asked my friend. I said, is he watching? He said, no. And I'm hitting all these licks and stuff. Is he watching? No. So when I'm finished, is he watching? He said, no. I said, oh, well. So we packed up. And as we were walking by, Lewis was really into a conversation with the LaBella spokesperson. Mm-hmm. As we were walking by, lo and behold, he grabs me by the shoulder, his shirt, and says, hey, come in for a minute. And I go, yeah. And he goes, hey, I want you to jam with me right now for LaBella Strings. I said, okay. I said, but we don't have any amps. He said, don't worry about that, man. Just come on.
Yeah.
And I'm supposed to say no. So I'm trying not to cough. I should have brought me a bottle of water. Get that out. Anyway, so we're there now. I'm on cloud nine, right?
Oh, yeah.
Eyes are this big. And I'm playing. We slapping. And I've been modeling after him so much. I was playing. I thumped just like him. Just the last few years, I've been trying to get out of that, you know, and create my own style.
Sure.
But my thumping, I didn't have to think about it. That's how I thump and I think just like he thinks. Mm-hmm. And I guess he felt that. And so, you know, and then I was talking to the audience. He grew a big crowd. We were playing unplugged with electric basses. We had like 40 people around us. And then they all applauded when we got finished.
Wow.
And then I was here I'm just going to walk away and do my thing. I was cool, you know?
Yeah.
I took about 5 steps, and he said, hey, come back. And he said, hey, man, I really liked your playing. And he says, you know, when I go out here and do these Brother Johnson gigs, you know, at that time, him and his brother, for some personal reason, had separated in their relationship. Mm-hmm. Two Brothers Johnson bands going on.
Gotcha.
So he got tired of hired guns right at the whim. He said he never felt comfortable playing with them. They have no rehearsals, and he's used to the old school way of rehearsing and everything.
Yeah.
He said he needed a band to do that. Will I be willing to? I ain't gonna say a bad word, but yeah.
Yeah.
You know what that first word is?
Oh, yeah. And,
so that started that. That started me just getting out there. Because once you play behind a major artist like that, and then, you know, I had a manager. I got a manager at the time, and the manager started marketing me behind. I'm Lewis Johnson's bass, backup bass player. Mm. The doors really started opening for me then, you know? So I started getting bigger gigs, more studio, the bigger studio gigs, money and stuff. You know what I mean? It was pretty nice. What else happened after that? So that stint was very short, though. It was only little under 2 years. I don't know if it was because of their contractual agreements with each other. And I wasn't by far not trying to get between two of both of them because I love both of them. You know what I mean? So whatever he wanted to do was cool with me. Mm-hmm. I was happy. We got to go out in my car one day and I took him out and he treated me to a Mexican restaurant and told me all these personal stories that I can't tell you right now.
That's all good.
I'm writing a book. You guys remember I said that.
Okay.
Yeah. From little old me. But anyway, so that started it, Raul, right there.
Gotcha.
And I just started playing, and but I still kept doing a lot of local stuff, you know what I mean? Because of I was married at the time, and I don't know, I guess that was just coming to me at that time. I wasn't flying around too many places. I went to Las Vegas, and that was fun. Yeah. You gotta know how to control yourself in places like that.
Oh, yeah.
But it was real fun doing them gigs up and down the coast of California with a band called the California Executives. They were kind of, what would you call that? sort of like a Temptations type group.
Okay.
I used to say Boosie meet the Temptations. I was Boosie and they were Temptations. I used to say that in the back of my mind, you know. But it learned a lot from being with them, though, backing up vocalists. Mm-hmm. How not to play so loud, how not to slap so much, you know. Because they look back, they'll let you know, you know. Mm-hmm. But they also my friends. So it was doing rehearsals when they told me these things, you know what I mean? Yeah. So I learned that way a long time ago. And stop playing so doggone much, you know what I mean? Let them sing, and how to roll with the keyboard player. It was really interesting. And they were really getting a lot of book gigs. Just Universal Studio. We were playing in these private clubs where, like, I saw the whole cast of Married with Children. It was like, I don't know. I can't remember the name of these places, but they had some real good management. You know, they was getting them some real secluded gigs, you know. Mm-hmm. So that gave me a lot of stuff, too, you know what I mean? Because these actors started seeing me then too, you know what I mean? Matter of fact, I got some lessons to teach one of, you know what I mean? And that's my first time that I charged somebody $150 for an hour. I was like, you know, this dude got money. I better not be too cheap, you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
And this is back in the 90s, you know what I mean?
Wow.
And that was great, you know what I mean? I don't want to say his name because he's pretty big now, and he's playing guitar now, and that's enough. That I'm
going to
tell you guys.
There you go. Oh, you be teasing it. People are going to have to keep an eye out for your book to get more details.
Right, right. So, I'll put it all in that book.
As I'm grasping it here, California scene, things are happening. You've been through some NAMM shows, Brothers Johnson, Funk,
of course,
teaching.
My second home was Hollywood.
Yeah.
I mentioned that. Since like the ninth grade,
mm-hmm.
every weekend I was catching a bus to Hollywood.
Got
that's a long ride from Carson, California to Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
But I forgot to mention that. I stayed out there. And everything, back in them days, everything wasn't so top security. You can knock on the door and tell them who you were. I'm just a guitar player, wanted to check out you guys, see what you're doing. And they would let you walk in to different sets and stuff, you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
Not all of them, but like 9 out of 10, nobody really never told me no.
Yeah.
So I used to do that a lot, you know what I mean? And get to hang out, watch people. Matter of fact, it was a girl group called Climax. They're a funk band from the 80s. Meeting in the ladies' room.
Okay.
See you back real soon.
Yeah.
Okay, it's too early to be trying to sing right now. But I met them at a place called Wilshire Fine Arts in Los Angeles. Well, I really wasn't hanging out. I was in my first rock band. I was curious about the other side of just funk, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I put in the papers that I'm influenced by Toto, Led Zeppelin, and all these groups. I had to do something, man.
Mm-hmm.
And somebody called me, and these guys were like 4 or 5 years older than me, but I could play, you know?
Sure.
And I went and I checked that out, but to not get lost on your storytelling here, that those studios were just all over California, and I've been there all my life, native. So I took advantage of all that stuff, you know what I mean?
Gotcha.
Like, and then by hanging out in Hollywood, I would see Howard Hewitt and Jackie from 227 just hanging out at the movies, the French Prince dad eating hot dogs with a bunch of people. You know, I lived out there, and I was living in it, you know what I mean? And so for some reason, this is a big part of my book too, is that none of these people turn me away when I approach them. You know what I mean? So I just call it a godsend, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I'm getting super religious on nobody, but yeah.
Oh yeah. So you dabbled a little in rock, and then what came next?
Also did some reggae.
Okay.
I'm not crazy about reggae. Sorry for you reggae fans, but being professional, I think you should know a little bit about every genre, you know? I got that from Nathan East a long time ago.
Yeah.
When he said when he was going to school, he wanted to be everybody's bass player. And
yeah.
I said, I like that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know? So I took that on that fashion a long time ago. So I was playing in a lot of bands that you wouldn't believe it. You know, I played in the Spanish thing, what they call it.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
Samba? I don't know what the music is, but you know, where they got the hats and stuff on.
Sure, sure.
And it's really like it's one five. It's a lot of one fives in there. It's like country.
Yeah.
You know. Yeah. Or a fast bossa nova. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
It was. I could see how it was all intertwined and related to each other. And I just kept doing that for a while. And then I think I see what you're getting at. Where I work, I got not tired, but I wanted to get out of my comfort zone, mm-hmm. and to another level. And this is not too long ago. This was just, I just started thinking like this around 2000. It's in the 2000s, see what I mean? Three,
okay.
You know? Yeah, where I said, you know what? I'm ready to, I started talking to my boys and, you know, Chucky and all these guys. And I'm like, you know, man, I think I'm ready to step it on up now, you know? So I started stepping up in every area, you know? I started going for the bigger gigs, advertising more.
Mm-hmm.
I got another manager, and I just started doing the same things I've been doing, but just at a higher level. And then somebody kept teasing me about, not tease me, but I kept having everybody say, how come you don't write anything? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I pretty, a lot of my stuff been behind peer pressure from my compadres.
Yeah.
And I was doing a demo. My debut CD is really my demo.
Okay.
I just wanted to do just for somebody when they come by the house or something. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Check me out, man. Look what I'm working on. And a lot of guys said, man, they kept telling me to put that out. I didn't want to, personally, but they were, the way they were talking to me, they were like, listen, I said, man, I really didn't have the budget I wanted, I didn't have this. They said, stop complaining. Just show a body of work, man. You're trying to step it up another level.
Mm-hmm.
People see your work ethic when you, they see a compilation of something.
Got
and
it.
That's when I got that term body of work locked into my mind, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And when I did that, and it's on sale still today on my website, we'll talk about later.
Mm-hmm.
excuse me. When I did that raw road, my phone calls just started coming in, and it really kind of solidified everything for me. You know what I mean? And then I want to mention this because whoever these people are might see this. Hopefully they do. Whoever it was. I first started selling my CD on Reverb Nation.
Mm.
I want to tell whoever from Japan bought 9,000 copies.
Oh wow!
And they unanimous. I don't. They don't want us. They don't. I can't find out who did it.
Uh-huh.
Today I want to say thank you and please contact me. But what that did, Raul, when I did that, Reverb Nation started that at that time. They were hooked up with CD Baby and all these companies.
Mm-hmm.
They were shooting emails to all these people who sold a lot of records. And that was a lot for 2012.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And I laughed because I'm like, that? You know? But so I did that. Then I sold 1,100 here in the United States. No, let me back it up. Because right now, it said 9,800. So I think they bought 8,000 something and I sold 11. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I'm trying to sell like about something like 200 more to get to that 10,000 mark.
Gotcha.
And they give you this nice little trophy looking thing with a record with your CD on it.
Uh-huh.
Now, yeah.
The CD, that is that Nujazzfunk that we're talking about?
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay.
And you want a little bit about that?
Tell me about that.
Okay. When I did that, it was kind of, like I said, you know why I did it already, but I was at my mother's house and I was going through a lot of, I don't want to stay on this too long, but I just like to let stuff out. It's good for me. I had a lot of deaths in my family.
Oh, wow.
And these were main figures in my family. That even made it worse.
Mm-hmm.
My grandmother, the one who bought me my first bass, she used to clean houses for the Jacksons and Sammy Davis and all that. And she showed me these. She used to take me with her sometimes, these big mansions and stuff. Mm-hmm. And I remember one time when I was like 18, she trusted me and my girlfriend to clean one of these houses while she had a doctor's appointment.
Oh, wow.
That was real. It was nice, real strange, but it was really weird to see how people living, you know what I mean?
Sure.
I mean, they had a schedule on the refrigerator how to chop up the steak. What you call it? The cube steak for the little poodle.
Oh, you know? My gosh.
Yeah, the poodle gets his hair done on a certain day, his nails painted. Then I go in another room. They have this little baby. Mm-hmm. They had a baby. And the baby wasn't there, but they got the baby modeling already for Kodak. You know what I mean?
So oh, yeah. This,
you go into the living room. It's white carpet. I've never mm-hmm. seen that before, with a big baby grand white piano.
Uh-huh.
So the thing was, when you're cleaning houses, you can look any room you want to. Just don't touch. You know what I mean? I go in the bedroom to clean up. The closet is a wine cellar.
Oh, wow.
So, you know, she just introduced me to a higher standard of living, you know? And it was just like, wow, look at this stuff, you know? I kind of got off track.
Yeah, back to your CD, Nujazzfunk.
Okay. So I was doing a demo, and like I said, I was on a shoestring budget at the time. And I remember, I have so much equipment. You can't really see nothing in here right now because of the camera angles. But I've been blessed with so much equipment. You know, I always want to remember that. You know what I mean? Take nothing for granted. And the guitar, the dude who plays, the dude who produced it, my album, my CD at the time, his name is Tim Law. He kind of did a little something with the Isley Brothers back in the days. Some other groups I forgot right now. But he took a liking to a few things in my studio. And so I bargained some equipment to get this CD done.
Sure.
You know what I mean? Some stuff that I really didn't really care about too much, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Some of it was probably like one of the guitars, I think it was kind of like a collector's item when I think about it now. But oh well, it had to go at that time. I wasn't thinking like that. So gotcha. I sold some kind of Les Paul looking guitar, and he was crazy about that. I mean, I gave it to him for some studio time.
Sure.
I gave him some kind of a Roland. No, I didn't give him that. I didn't give him a keyboard. Some pedals and stuff. You know, and
there was a little bit of bartering going on there to help things, you know, kind of get through. Gotcha.
I remember everything. But anyway, moving right along. It was basically me and him in there doing that, and then some of his musician friends.
Okay.
The slack on the other instruments. And I wasn't trying to sing or nothing. You hear me in there, I'm doing a little talking. It's supposed to be just an instrumental, fun CD.
Okay.
You know what I mean? All of them songs are fun, pretty much, to me. And I wanted to take, I kept hearing about new jazz. I'm a late bloomer when it comes to jazz.
Mm-hmm.
Like I told you, I did a little walking thing back in 93 at the college, but I didn't take it nowhere past that. But here it is. I started working on this CD in 2011. I wanted to get into jazz, but I really wasn't quite ready to do it on the CD. So I said, wait a minute. I studied this thing called new jazz. You know how you go on cable TV and you just punch the different things to see the different types of music? It'd be like a blue screen.
Yeah, yeah.
So I just kept flicking through and I said, oh, I found it. So I listened to it for about 6 hours that day. And I said, oh, I get the point. It's just music with a jazzy type flavor, you know?
Gotcha.
I did that. And so I said, that's what I'm going to do with this stuff. So what I did was I mixed the old school funk from my P-Funk days with a jazz type flavor. So I wanted to come out with something that wasn't so just right on whatever somebody else was doing.
Mm-hmm.
You could hear some of that bootsy stuff coming out on some of my stuff and some of that Larry Lewis Johnson, but I was trying to stay away from being singled out, just, you know what I mean?
Exactly, standing in a niche.
So, yeah, so anyway, that's how new jazz funk came about. And like I said, I'm cool with it. I'm proud of it. And you don't get to, in anything you do, you have to start somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, so I'm proud of what I did at that time.
Gotcha.
It's time for some new stuff to come out now with my transformation.
Gotcha.
That's the title of my new CD. I want the single to come out sometime in July. That's kind of like my testing ground. And then the rest of the compilation will be out in November.
Nice. Now, you talked a little bit about gear, and I know that it's for every bassist, your instrument is a big part of your voice. And yeah. We kind of initially made this connection because I know that you're playing on Paul Larrey basses.
Right.
Right now. So tell us a bit about your gear. And again, I know people have probably been looking over your shoulder the whole time going, hey, I see a bunch of stuff. So tell us a little bit more about what you're playing on.
Well, you know, it was something again like a what would they call it? Epitome?
Mm-hmm.
The right word? Where just it just seemed like a spiritual thing to me, you know? And I was flipping through the internet one day, and his bass just popped up out of nowhere.
Gotcha.
I don't know if it was on the side with the advertisements or whatever, mm-hmm. but it just popped up and it hit me right in the face. Because I was always looking for something, you know, me being as funky as I am and, you know, Bootsy Collins being my biggest inspiration growing up.
Sure.
Okay. So you can imagine that I just wasn't the average Fender Jazz type dude. Do you know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
I mean, I play them for, you know, when people request them and everything, but I was trying to come, I'm trying to come into my own now. And I said, well, I need something of my phone that says something about me.
Sure.
And when I saw that bass, Raul, I was locked in.
Gotcha.
And, excuse me, the next time I called him from France and we talked. And just like I'm talking to you now, we talked and I told him all this stuff and what I'm doing and everything. And he liked how I was promoting with Schecter.
Okay.
Schecter was my first bass endorsement. And I did a few videos with Schecter. Just home videos right out the house, you know what I mean? No scripts and, you know what I mean? My own little camera and everything. And he liked it. He liked that. And he says I have a big internet presence. He did some research on me or something.
Gotcha.
And I am over 40 sites to count and counting. Because, you know, some sites pick you up from other sites. I didn't know that.
Sure.
But I have permission. But it's good for me as long as they're not selling nothing, you know?
Yeah. And, well, that's why they call it the web, because everything is linked together, you know? Okay. So, yeah.
That's great. And anyway, so he sent my contract through the email. And I signed it. And I went to pick up my bass at the first NAMM show 2016. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And that's the one, it's all wood.
Okay.
It's like five different types of wood. I love his basses because it's not just the difference in style. He's a great woodworker, but you gotta have sound to go with that too. You
mm-hmm.
know what I mean? I played a lot of bass at the NAMM show. To me, it didn't sound like nothing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, I couldn't get no work using them.
Mm-hmm.
Guys at the studio, they're real funny. You know, if you don't get that Fender Jazz sound out, or some in a P bass or Music Man, they'll tell you to put that $5,000-$6,000 bass down. You know?
Oh, yeah.
They will have no problem telling you that. And so when I got there, I was excited about, because I made the deal without even hearing all those tones. I was going on a whim, you know, because of the things that were in the bass. See, I studied bass guitar for years, not just playing it, but the different types of wood, how they sound.
Mm-hmm.
Like your maple and your maple neck with a swamp ass body gives you that more snap, pop and snap, the highs and lows when you're thumping and plucking.
Sure.
You know, Mark Miller uses that combination a lot. And Larry Graham also.
Mm-hmm.
And when you use darker tones, the mahoganies and stuff, you know what I mean? When you start layering those different types of wood and with the different fretboards, it does actually change the tone. You know
sure.
what I mean? So when he was talking about all this different stuff in the electronics, I knew about all the pickup companies because I've been playing all these basses at the NAMM shows. And I don't just play them, I'm checking them out.
Sure.
And they had Delanos from Germany, these pickups.
Mm-hmm.
Favorites on there. And I was like, wow. Wow.
Well, and one of the things with the Larray basses is the bodies. They're not big body. He's done a really unique thing where less is kind of more. And I'll share some images of them. But
yeah.
it kind of goes contrary to what you would think with the wood being a critical issue, because there doesn't seem to be as much wood on them, but there is.
But he's taking it out in the right places.
Gotcha.
You know? And that's really good on my back too, you know, because I had some back issues. prior to getting with Paul Lerat. You know what I mean? Gotcha. So when I'm wearing his bass, it's just, and it's balanced nice. It's not neck heavy or nothing. He really knows what he's doing, you know? I read up on him a little bit. He was a carpenter and stuff, like a lot of them cats, before he got into doing guitars, you know? Gotcha. Master, dude, the guy is, he know how to work with some wood. And also the electronics come from, every part of my bass is from all around the world. The pickups are from Germany, Delano. The preamp system is made by East. What's the guy's name in East? I forgot already. from the UK.
Okay, okay.
East, golly, that's terrible. Jamesy, I'm going to say.
We'll have people look it up, East.
Yeah.
Out of the UK.
They know what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. And those pickups are, that's the, excuse me.
Preamp.
The preamp, yeah. And those things are great, man. That's a combination made in heaven.
Mm-hmm.
And from there, I just ran with it. But when I played it at the NAMM show, I dialed in that Fender jazz sound, and I was like, yes. Because, see, it got everything else in it. You can do all this other stuff, make up all these different tones. But I wanted to be also my work bass, so I don't have to carry so many basses. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Now, like I said, I bought it for myself. Excuse me. I bought it for myself, but I wanted also for my own solo stuff, but I also wanted to use it when I'm backing people up.
Sure.
And so that worked.
And just got a new one, right? Because I saw the white one at the 2017 show.
Oh, now that's my baby.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. That one is the Paul Lerat Stega bass on steroids.
Okay.
It has a custom paint job that's out of this world. When they say pearl white, I had to get 5 different white straps to match it. The straps wasn't matching up with the paint. You know what I mean? It was like that. And I'm with Levi's Leathers also. So
mm-hmm.
looked out for me and got me the right strap to match that bass. But besides the paint job, I went way out on this one because, you know, I'm not getting any younger. And I told you, I'm shooting there. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
So this was mainly for my solo artist stuff, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And it's just that I want to make a name with these basses. I was so happy with the first one. So I really custom tailored this one from the ground up. It's a limited edition. I have the number 2 model. I think they're only going to make 20 of them.
Nice.
I really wasn't really kind on the gold plated stuff because I'm wondering about the wear on it. But he gave me a guarantee on that. And my wife wanted to go.
Yeah.
She's my manager currently right now and my biggest fan and supporter, you know what I mean?
Yay.
I'm lucky that is. She's a music lover, you know what I mean?
Totally.
Every time I'm going somewhere, she wants to go. But anyway, she said, get the gold, man.
Get the gold.
It makes a statement.
I'm yeah.
Like, really? I said, well, what the heck? Because I was going to get it all chromed out, you know?
Sure.
Anyway, it has a 24 karat gold frets. That's something different.
Nice.
Well, only person I've seen doing that is Ritter, you know? I think he's from Germany or somewhere.
Definitely.
Yeah. But he has a gold plated frets, gold plated tuners, machine heads, mm-hmm. gold plated bridge, nice. Gold plated control knobs, and gold plated bass strings. Yes. Bass strings come from, hey, I got a pack right here anyway.
Yep. So you were going to talk to us about strings, because I know you got your packs there.
Yeah. I'm also endorsed with this new company. Well, I don't want to say new, but they're new to me, called Optima Strings. Can you guys see that?
Yes, we can.
Okay. One of them is, reason I got 2 packs held up is, one is chrome plated.
Mm-hmm.
The other one is gold plated.
Wow.
Very deep. And these are the studio editions. They're called studio bass chrome strings, studio bass gold strings. And these strings, man, I use the gold on my Stega bass, the custom bass.
Mm-hmm.
Use the chrome on a. I have a Bootsy star shaped space bass.
Gotcha.
It's real funky, and I got a crazy strap on in the makings right now. I wish I'd have had it for the interview. And but you can use them on any bass. I just use them on these two basses. They're kind of custom, so I got some custom strings for them.
Sure.
One more thing I wanted to say about strings. I'm fortunate to be with two string companies. I thought that was going to be a problem, but they both serve me in different ways. Now, these strings are made by Black Diamond.
Okay.
They've been around, 89 years or something.
Oh, yeah.
I got interested in using these strings because I'm watching music directors now a lot. Like I said, Nathan East, Ricky Minor, Adam Blackstone. Sure. He's a young cat coming in on the East Coast, playing for Alicia Keys and Usher and everybody. And he uses these strings. And you know Andy Winston?
Mm-hmm.
Is this his last name? I haven't talked to Andy in a while. He's the Warren guy.
Okay, yeah. And I know who you're talking about. I'm just as bad with names too, but I know it's.
I think everybody knows Andy. I'm just gonna say Andy from Warwick.
That's right. Well, it'll come back to me.
Yes, but, man. I'm like, I don't know why I'm not missing these last names today, but he's a good dude. Who got me? You know, he gave me a lot of questions regarding endorsements and stuff. You know, and early on he supported me and stuff, and you know, just being there for me.
Mm-hmm.
He uses these, and so I tried some, man. And these things here, baby, when you want to back somebody up, you know, I'm not talking about going out there doing your solo thing. I'm talking about backing somebody up.
Yeah.
It gives such a piano sound. When I put these strings on, now I told you my wife loves music, but she's not that deep into music where she knew the difference when I put these on.
Gotcha.
So that's a big statement there. Mm-hmm. But in a nutshell, let me tell you the bass world what they do. When you put them on, what's different from these bass strings and a lot of other bass strings, and I'm just saying it from an honest opinion, not trying to sell nothing or nothing, that when you're backing vocalists up, when you're sliding around neck different positions, no string noise.
Okay.
And around wilds, just all bass. So they love that when you're playing behind, especially these females.
Mm-hmm.
They start hearing all that skeet skeet and all that stuff.
Yeah.
And in the studio, you don't have to worry about messing with your tone controls and stuff. You just play flat and put these babies on. So when I'm really working for somebody, I'm doing these. When I'm doing my own, my solo stuff, and a few other artists,
mm-hmm.
I use these.
Nice.
Okay.
Now, since you're touching toys here, I see you've got a pedal next to your strings. Tell us a little bit about the pedal you got.
Oh, okay. This is last but not least. This is a pedal. Can you see that?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. This is a bass pedal made by a company called Panda Mini.
Okay.
I'm trying to get my thoughts together because they're in another country too. But let me talk until that comes back to mind.
Sure.
One thing I like I said, I suggest to the people in the bass world who don't know any better, don't just buy something because you see it in a magazine or because your favorite artist is using it.
Mm-hmm.
Do some research, especially with the computer nowadays.
Oh, yeah.
You can check out the background or something, its origin. You can compare it to other models. They have what they call gear talks all on the internet.
Sure.
I saw that before I grabbed something. You know what I mean? I don't just grab it because of advertisement. And this thing here, what it does that a lot of bass synths doesn't do, it's a bass synth.
Okay.
It's called the Future Impact 1. They had another model come out in the 70s and 80s. I forgot the name of it because this interview is not sketched. I wasn't planned.
Yeah.
But there's older model to this that was real popular, but whoever was making it didn't have the money or something, and it closed up. And so those models worth like $1,500.
Yeah.
It was something like, let me see, Red Impact, something. Anyway, let me get on along with this.
Mm-hmm.
So what I like about this, when you're getting some, see, I use a lot of effects And so since I've been schooled on them, the reason a lot of bass players don't like to use a lot of effects is because the tracking. It's either the tracking or the tone.
Gotcha.
You have something that is not really made for a bass. It's like really made for a guitar or something.
Yeah.
And it pulls all, it sucks all the bass out of your system.
Mm-hmm.
But since I love to use pedals, because I'm from the P-Funk era,
yeah,
I'm not going to stop. I had to do some schooling and get the right ones, put them in the right positions. That also matters a lot, too, when you got a huge pedal board as big as mine. If you put things in the wrong place, you can get different types of effects out of it.
Mm-hmm.
So this pedal, man, is the tracking is. I'm going to do some videos on this, you guys.
Nice.
I mean, in a really, like in about 3 to 4 weeks. I just got it. I've had it like 2 months, right before the NAMM show. But I didn't want to rush and do a video and not know what I'm talking about. You know what
sure.
I mean? So I've been reading up and experimenting with it and everything because it has a lot of different stuff going on with it. But look to see a video up on this this pedal. If you want to get one, you just go to pandamini.com or just put Future Impact in your Google.
You'll find it, yeah.
Yeah, these bad boys are, they're the thing.
Nice.
And also, this is what I want to mention about this pedal. This will be on my new CD.
Ah.
I'm getting kind of crazy again.
Nice. Now, everybody knows that you can't have a pedal without having an amplifier, and you're playing through Trainer, right?
Yes. I know you heard about Trainer, haven't you, Raul?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, Raul. Trainer, for a lot of these young cats out there, you know, Trainer came out before they was born. Trainer been around about almost 54 years now.
Wow.
And I used to see them back when I was a kid, but they were more geared towards rock and roll back in the day.
Mm-hmm.
And what I mean by that, if you just get that fat, round P bass sound. But what a lot of people need to realize, though, is that with modern technology the way it is today,
mm-hmm.
and the computer era and all this stuff, you need to look at each and every company.
Gotcha.
And just the ones you see all the bass players chasing after. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, I do research on everything, and I'm not taking away from other amps at all.
Mm-hmm.
I got some great stuff out there. But this was on my top list to go see at the NAMM show before all these other big name brands that you're more familiar with.
Yeah.
And I said, wow, these cats been around for a long time. I bet they got some new stuff out there. You never know. And lo and behold, I went out there to the NAMM show this past in January 2017. And can you get a little peek at that?
I can. I'll put up a still so people can see it better. But yeah, we see it in the corner.
Cool. Anyway, I don't like to follow other people's leads on music now.
Sure.
I've been doing this for so long. I've come into my own, and like with the wild basses, Paula Red basses,
sure,
and gold plated strings. But also, well, I guess I don't have to turn around like I'm talking to my bass amp.
Yeah.
But this bass amp on the side of me over here is my baby, man. It's another dream come true. I'm endorsed with Trainer Amplifiers. Thank you, mm-hmm. Steve Boss. And they're out of Canada. I didn't know that. I thought Trainer was an American company. Now, they have a company in Canada. They have one in New York.
Okay.
I guess to deal with everybody out here.
Mm-hmm.
But they didn't mesh, their technology from back in the days, you know, working 54 or something years.
Yeah.
With modern technology, man, and they got a screamer here.
Gotcha.
They got the new SB500 head. It's lighter than any other head. I almost mentioned a name, but I don't like to make companies compete against each other. But yeah, you might see that other stuff sitting back there. I don't know.
Yeah.
But I have a lot of gear in here. But it's the lightest bass head I picked up. It's so light, it feel like nothing's in it.
Oh, wow, nice.
It's kind of scary, you know what I mean? I'm like, wow, this thing gonna blow up on me or something? What is this? And baby, I plugged that up, Raul, to a, I got a different configuration that's not real popular, but people use it, but it's not the 410, it's not the 210. It's a combination of a 210, a nice big old compression horn,
mm-hmm.
and a 15, baby.
Oh, nice.
All in one cabinet. See, so I get my highs, my mids, and my lows, because I hate all those buttons. I really do.
Yeah.
You know, I set everything on flat when I first brought this thing home, and I back up off the mid just a little bit, because, you know, I do a lot of slapping and popping.
Mm-hmm.
And that bad boy just sings, and I've tried everybody. From what I like, I never heard nothing sound so deep and solid with no distortion if I heard this. So I'm really going to be pumping this. I just emailed the guy yesterday about it. But I was so shocked and happy, I just couldn't believe it. Because I heard it at the NAMM show, but it's different when you bring it home, you know what I mean? And, man, I'm so proud to be an endorser with them. And you guys get a chance, check that out. That trainer, man, like I said, it's modernized. And I have everything in one cabinet. And the cabinet's not that bad. Plus, I throw the casters on there. Excuse me. Mm-hmm. But I get everything right there with a flat setting, 12 o'clock setting, and I don't have to tweak nothing. I get Music Man. Now, that's something different.
Yeah.
You know, I got a Music Man out there, sound out there for the first time ever. You know, I play a lot of old school stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I play Brothers Johnson stuff, you know what I mean? Even though I'm not with the band, because people know I've been connected with him, they ask me when I go for an audition, hey, mm-hmm. I heard you look good. Play some of that Brother Johnson stuff.
Yeah.
But now when I play it, it sounds exactly like the record. And that was frightening. It scared me, really. It was so thin. Because I didn't know what that sound was at first. I just knew it was dead on.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, I said, wait a minute. Yeah. That Music Man sound. Oh, goodness. Now I got jazz, P bass, and Music Man coming out my Paul the Rat.
Nice.
Man.
Nice. Well, and again, I appreciate, because I know you're so busy and you've taken time. I want to make sure before we go, because you, one of the things that definitely you have figured out is interacting with the companies and the endorsements. Yes. Things. What kind of advice would you give? Because I know we get a lot of questions from young musicians
mm-hmm.
that are asking us, hey, can you help me or all this? And I'm like, no, this is stuff you got to do on your own, you know.
Yeah.
But what advice would you give somebody who would like to get, you know, endorsements like you have?
Hi, everybody. Here it comes. I'm glad to have this interview because I get asked this so much. And I'm not a selfish guy at all.
Mm-hmm.
But it's enough room for everybody. What I found out from talking to a few people is the preparedness. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Don't just walk into a situation not prepared. Nowadays, you don't have to have a physical bio. You can have a press kit over the internet. And all that is, for people who don't know, is it could be one page. And you have to sit back at home, though, and sit back and draw, like I talked this interview, and talk about your future, your past, present, and future.
Mm-hmm.
They need to get into your minds and see what who you are and what can you do for them.
Yeah.
You know, you know. Yes, you play bass, and they don't care how fast you play bass, unless you're Victor Wooten or somebody.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So you know, you're introducing yourself to them. That's first thing. So get your press kit, and you don't have to pay for a lot of stuff. Like I said, I started off with Reverb Nation, then I went on there and I got my own website now. You pay a low monthly fee. You can find a million a month on there.
Sure.
You know? And even they have templates and all that stuff to help you out nowadays.
Mm-hmm.
Get your website started. You don't need to wait till you're big and famous to get a website.
Gotcha.
It's a business move.
Mm-hmm.
When you get exposure.
Mm-hmm.
People around the world see it. Connected to the web. So that's advice. Know what you're talking about when you check whatever gear you're interested in. Do some research on the gear before you get there.
Mm-hmm.
First, because they're really impressive when you get there. You know what you're talking about, you know, and you compare it to other instruments.
Sure.
And so they don't think you just come to get free gear. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You got, you know, I talk to so many other guys, and they tell me these stories about all these guys calling them, and they get this free gear, and then it's run off. You never hear from them again.
Yeah.
And just like I said, let me slow down this, because I'm an expert in this pretty much now. preparation, yeah. Then you get to the website. Okay, and also, don't bug them. Find out who you're talking to, and be polite as you can. You want to talk to the artist relations guy at these places. You can look them up on the web. Sometimes you have to do some serious searching for them. Some of them want to be listed. but the internet, you will find them.
Yeah.
And I would say first, instead of calling them, email them. You know, because more people have time to check the email later when they have time than to stop on the phone and hear you talking about some getting some gear from them. You know
sure.
what I mean? That's really like the least phone call they really want to take.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
These guys are busy too. So with that advice, I would say keep pushing. And also I learned this from doing I wrote a paper when I was in college about endorsements. Ain't that something?
Yeah.
And what I learned by doing that research for that assignment was, you know, not everybody's going to say yes to you. Mm-hmm. So have that in mind so your spirits and your feelings don't get crushed. You know, everybody's not meant to be with everybody. Mm-hmm. Or some people, like I'm talking to some people, like a couple of companies I really wanted to get with, but they were flooded with bass players already.
Gotcha.
And you know, come on, the guy can't take on the whole world. You know what I mean?
Sure.
So be prepared for the letdown sometime, and just go to find another company, and just keep pushing and keep praying, and find ways to that damn show.
There you go.
Yeah, it's worth an airplane trip and a 4-day hotel stay. Yes, you know what I'm talking about.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, you'll experience something you've never experienced in life, and. That's it, baby.
There you go. Well, looking ahead, and I know we've talked about so much, and again, I appreciate your time with this, but where's the best place for people to find out more about you? A web address, where's the best? Because I know you've got the upcoming project. You know, where do we look for what's coming up?
I'm going to give you my home base, because mm-hmm. I'm on the internet a lot. But if you go to my home base, you can always catch up with me without, you know, linking everything together.
Sure.
My whole base is a lot of my sites are hooked up to it, but it's my hub. It's mm-hmm. robertharperbass.com.
Gotcha.
First, my last name in base, all connected, one big word, .com. And I have also have little stores on there. You can buy the CD, the debut CD I did. It's going to be a collector's item one of these days, you guys.
Oh, yeah.
That I did in 2012. Right there, you can get your downloads or whatever. Right there. What else? I also have an online store that has t-shirts and different little things, hat, base caps, and all this stuff. You know what I mean? If you're a Robert Harper fan or you want to collect the souvenirs, you know what
yeah.
I mean? I'm trying to, the reason I say that, I got some big players that I reached out to for this new CD.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to do a lot of playing. You're going to hear me play some rhythm guitar myself. A lot of people didn't know I played guitar. But Shetra's gonna hook me up with this nice purple guitar. It's so pretty. I show it off, you guys, when I get it. A couple of weeks, matter of fact, about 3 weeks. And I'm gonna be playing rhythm guitar. I'm gonna be playing bass and some drums on this CD and some percussion. But this is all I can say. I got somebody from P-Funk gonna be playing on my album, I think, you guys.
Oh, nice.
Nice. He talks about everything, and that's looking good, you know? Did you hear that whisper?
I did. We got that. We paid attention.
All right.
Well, Robert, again, thank you so much for taking time. People, Robert Harper, I mean, this is just a wealth of information. I'm sure if you need to know more, you know how to reach him, contact him. I mean, you know, couldn't be a nicer guy, and I'm sure he's more than happy to share a little gem of wisdom and what he can there, because he's lived the life, you know, and he knows the ropes. Well, again, folks, you've seen it. Robert Harper here on Bass Musician Magazine.